Great. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Christo Els. I'm the senior partner at Webber Wentzel. This is the seventh of these sessions we have on our webinar series. I'm joined this afternoon by my partner, Nozipho Mngomezulu. Nozipho and I will be covering why we chose Webber Wentzel. We'll tell you a little bit of background about ourselves, about our journey. We'll speak about the firm's reputation, the standing and culture of the firm. Also, we'll share with you some information about how we work in Africa and how we work on the rest of the globe with our alliance partner, Linklaters, as well. I also want us to have some time at the end to answer your questions. So by all means, there's a Q&A button on your screen. Please do type in your questions. We will get to that at the end. It's always more fun if we can make this a little bit interactive. And I always say to students, when we have these conversations, within reason, you can ask us anything. Do post your questions and we'll try and deal with that. I'll refer you to our website at the end as well, but this session will be recorded, as if some of your colleagues or friends couldn't make the session, it will be available on our website and also on social media. So please be able to post on social media, talk about this session if you want to, but more importantly, you'll be able to see the recording as well. So I would like to kickstart our session by inviting Nozipho to introduce herself, to tell us a little bit about herself, her background and journey, and then we'll come back to the rest of the agenda. Nozipho.
Thank you very much, Christo. My name is Nozipho Mngomezulu. I'm a partner at Webber Wentzel, specializing in telecommunications, media, technology, and intellectual property. I think that our practice group probably has the longest name of all of the other practices. So I joined Webber Wentzel 15 years ago. I started at the firm on the 10th of January 2005. And the reason why it is that I actually joined Webber Wentzel was because of the fact that Webber Wentzel at the time was the only practice group that had a media law practice. So I joined because of the fact that I was quite passionate about media law, and it made sense to me at the time to look to join a law firm that I could align myself with in terms of what it is that my passion was at the time. So I had studied at WITS, and I came to know about Webber Wentzel because of in interactions like these, where it is that Webber Wentzel came to our campus. And I learned about the various practices that were being offered at Webber Wentzel. And what it is that struck me was the fact that, my goodness, I could actually find a law firm that actually catered to my love for everything media. I think that I probably am one of the very few 30-year-olds in this country that know the names of Kim Kardashian's kids, and and can tell you a whole lot about media-related issues, simply because I have a love for pop culture. And so what it is that I thought was, well, I got into law, and there's a law firm out there that actually specializes in this other passion of mine. So it made sense for me to actually try to join Webber Wentzel. And so I've been at Webber's for ever since. And when it is that I got interviewed, I expressed my passion for the media. And I was lucky enough to rotate in the media law practice group. And that's where it is that I've been ever since. And so it's been a whirlwind of a ride, but it's been a ride that is absolutely awesome and that I absolutely love. I wake up every day smiling because of the fact that I get to do what it is that I'm passionate about on a day-to-day basis. And I think that that's it for me, Christo, on why it is, on how it is that I ended up where it is that I am.
Thanks, Nozipho. I must say, the one benefit of these sessions is you learn something new of your partners. Didn't know you had a Kim Kardashian fantasy there. I remember that for the future. So yeah, my journey, I suppose, I studied law because in grade four, the teacher said to me that she can only see that I become a lawyer. I suspect what she meant was I talked too much in class, and maybe that was the reason. But anyway, that planted the seed. And since then, you know, I was always destined to become a lawyer. Grew up in Pretoria and went to university in Pretoria. In those days, you know, Nozipho, you say that you had career days. Maybe it was just that the Joburg firms didn't come to Pretoria, but we had no career days. I knew nothing about any firm. Nobody in my family has ever been a lawyer. So I had very good marks, and you know, I don't know whether it's ambition or I was a bit too full of myself, but I only applied to, in those days we had a book called Hortus, which listed all the kind of firms in the country and the names of their partners. So I just picked the four largest firms in the country and sent my CV to them. Webber's was the second interview I did. As I say, I literally knew nothing of any of the firms. Didn't like anybody in the first interview, so lucky for me, I didn't take that opportunity. And then when I interviewed with Webber Wentzel, I just, you know, just felt like home. It was a big panel that did the interview. I, you know, really got on with the people there. They made me an offer that afternoon. And you know, I moved from after university, then from Pretoria to Johannesburg, which in those days really felt like you were going far. Maybe it was just, you know, I wasn't used to going anywhere. So there was a big adjustment to come to Joburg, and so I've been at Webber Wentzel I'm in my 25th year at Webber Wentzel. I cannot imagine that I would be able to or want to work at any other firm. I often look back at that decision and just, you know, thank. I'm really grateful that I was given that opportunity, and that by some luck I ended at Webber Wentzel. It really is a place where, apart from the work we do, the reputation the firm has, which we can speak to a little bit later, it really is a place where, you know, I found people that I kind of get on, both in the office but also socially. A lot of my friends now, having been here for 25 years, as you know, are people that you know, kind of grew up in the firm with me. You know, people that I was doing articles together, or the associate I worked for when I started the firm, etc. And that's a really nice place. It does feel like family. So that a little bit of the history as to how I got here. I just want to share one other story. I've got plenty of stories I think I can share, but I really want to share this one story. Whether it was because you know, my background maybe was a bit different, Joburg was quite scary for me, and so on. I struggled a bit in the beginning. You know, I loved the firm. I was really inspired by the work we did, the clients the firm had. But you know, I always felt that you know, I struggled to find a real place in the firm, and you know. Various things happened, but in the end, I was made an offer in the corporate department. In those days, we really only had three large departments, and I wanted to do corporate law because, you know, I was interested in both the economics of, you know, of transactions as well as the law. So M&A really appealed to me. But when I started, the firm said to me, listen, we want to retain you. We're happy with you. But we don't really think the particular partner I worked for didn't have enough work, he said, to really keep another associate in those days busy. So if I stay, I must basically undertake to go and find work amongst other partners in the firm. And in a way, you know, even though that made me less protected, it helped, because you know, you got to work with various people in the firm. You know, even internally, it kind of honed my entrepreneurial skills to try and find work from others. I think that was good. But even so, you know, in those early days, I really felt that it was, you know, on the one hand, I felt like nobody was really looking out for me. But more importantly, because you were working, I was ultimately eventually working for Bruce Cleaver, who's now the CEO of De Beers. And you know, Bruce was an incredible practitioner. I think the best M&A lawyer that the firm had. Certainly then, and we had a very good relationship. But because he had such a great name in the market, all of the instructions would kind of come to him. And for a young lawyer, it's always a challenge to try and find, you know, how do you shape your career that people see you as somebody other than Bruce's assistant, even though I was by then already a young partner. Something peculiar happened. One day, I received a phone call from Vodafone, and they were pursuing a transaction which ultimately would result in taking control of Vodacom. And the transaction at that time was buying the interest of the Remgro Group through Venfin into Vodafone. And as I said, I was a really young partner. It wasn't referred to me by anybody in the firm. And one thing in particular happened, which really shows the character of Webber Wentzel, in that even though I was completely out of my depth in running this transaction, we had a partner here, John Jarvis, who, you know, was quite an older partner, and he didn't really like working with juniors. But I went to him and said, you know, I've got this transaction, I will run it, but can you please check, you know, everything that I send out and kind of help me through it? And, you know, even though he was multiple years my senior, he was happy to be in the background, let me lead the transaction, read every document I sent out meticulously with his pencil. I remember, you know, changed my drafting, you know, helped me through it. And that gave me the confidence to do these type of big transactions, even though I was a young partner. And then the very interesting thing happened, because I always kind of wondered why it is that they phoned me. You know, they didn't really know me. And years later, I've done other transactions with them, and I spoke to the general counsel, and we became friends. And I said to him, you know, why don't you call me? You know, by then it was like, I don't know, 7 or 8 years ago. And that transaction completely changed my life, really, because the firm, always kind of seeing me as Bruce's assistant, suddenly saw me as somebody that can do these, but more importantly, bring these big transactions in. And the general counsel said to me, you know what, you once did, when they were setting up their operations in South Africa, they had a very small matter which really involved the memorandum drafting in those days, the articles, now the memorandum of association of their subsidiary company. And I did the work and sent it through, and they were happy with it. And then when they did a big transaction in South Africa, they had an internal kind of referral list, and my name was on it, and there was a comment that said I did the work really well. So they entrusted that enormous multi-billion rand transaction to me on the back of a good MRI that I drafted. Now, there's two lessons for me. They're a little bit in the alternative. The one lesson is the importance of doing everything you do as best that you can, and doing it excellently, because you never know where it could lead. I never gave you know, drafting an MRI on articles that much thought that, you know, it could lead to something like that. That's the first thing. But the second thing, which is almost more important, certainly in my mind, is that I had no recollection of ever drafting that set of articles or ever working with them before. So even today, I sometimes wonder whether they didn't confuse me with somebody else, and it was just luck that they ultimately came to me. And you know, those are the things that that shape your career sometimes. You know, going after what you want, doing everything that you can do as best that you can, but without a doubt, luck plays a part as well. So anyway, that's a little bit about my history. Nozipho, I also wanted to you know, ask you a little bit about, you know, once you were then in the firm, you know, what are the things that you really kind of experienced here? How did you make it your home? Maybe speak a little bit about the firm's standing and the reputation and things like that.
Thanks, Christo. Thanks. I guess the first thing, you spoke about John Jarvis. The one thing that I remember is that my John Jarvis was George Mazarakis, the former executive producer of Carte Blanche.
Yeah.
So some people may be aware that we are Carte Blanche's lawyers. We vet the program beforehand just to basically identify any legal issues and any contentious issues which may be involved in how it is that the insert is produced and presented. So when it is that I joined the firm, I used to go along with some of the partners at the time to go view the various inserts. And I used to basically sit at the back with my notepad, taking copious notes making sure that I just listen, not wanting to be in the limelight, not wanting to interrupt, and not wanting to basically, you know, be a nuisance to anyone. And what it is that he always used to do is to basically look at me after every insert, after every discussion, after every insert, and to say to me, what do you think? And that meant the world to me because of the fact that he gave me the voice that I really, really was too afraid to be able to showcase at that particular time. And what it is that I've now carried from that is that it's always important to always try to make sure that the people that are in your presence, that are in your orbit, you are able as a leader to make sure that you try to cultivate that voice and to try to nurture that voice and to not try to suppress that voice. So that's something that stood out for me. And from a cultural point of view, I think that that's what the firm really does get right, in the sense that each and every single individual in the firm is able to be themselves, is able to express themselves, and is able to be able to say that, hang on, this is who I am. This is what it is that I bring to the table, because of the fact that the firm allows that for the most part. The firm is such that it's structured in a way that enables people, because of the fact that we focus so much on diversity. We emphasize, and what it is that the firm does best is that it is able to say to individuals that whoever it is that you are, whatever it is that you bring to the table, that is absolutely fine, provided that you can deliver, that you live up to our values. We welcome diversity, we encourage diversity, and that goes a long way insofar as how it is that you are able to make people comfortable, insofar as building the loyalty that you want to have where individuals are concerned.
Yeah, Nozipho, sorry to interrupt you, but I think that mentorship and sponsorship is so important to any lawyer really in an organization. That's really how we find our way, you know, having somebody that kind of does that for you. So I think it's important to be that for others, but also find somebody that could be that for you. Now, you talk about diversity and you know, the ability of the firm to really bring, you know, all excellent lawyers into our midst. It reminds me of we had a campaign, which we're restarting again this year, but about a year and a half ago, we had a campaign called Know My Name, Know My Story. It was really about showcasing individuals within the firm. You know, it's a big firm, you know, so there's between 700 and 800 people, depending on where. It's probably now about 750 people at the moment. It's important that everybody knows, even though we're in this organization that is, you know, has such a reputation in the country and internationally, but we have individuals here, and it's important to get to know each other. And every one of those that we showcased for me was a revelation as to what incredibly interesting people we have within the firm.
Yeah, no, absolutely. So, Christo, perhaps maybe you can now at this point touch on the firm's reputation, the firm's standing and culture.
Great. Thanks, Nozipho. Yeah, so as I said, the firm does have an outstanding reputation, both in South Africa as well as internationally. The firm is 152 years old this year, which sounds incredibly old. But it's a reputation that's been built on very strong client service, and then attracting and keeping the best talent. Yeah, the only way a firm survives as long as that, going through, you know, all the history that is involved in that, is to make sure that we keep on bringing the best people in the market to our firm. Mm-hmm. So that's what makes it so great that we can talk to all of you as you look at your careers. We are really interested in bringing the best and the brightest into our firm. I think another thing that's really important in the firm is our deep matter expertise. So, you know, of course, we're one of the large firms in the country, but very importantly is that we have not one or two people that are experts in a particular area. I think the one thing that really sets us apart is the deep expertise in every single of the areas that we practice in. There's always a team of people that can serve as a client that are not reliant on one person's reputation. It's good that the firm has that reputation and that clients can then be served by a whole team of lawyers. I think that's really, really important. And in the end, that's where the clients that, that distinguishes us from other firms, where you know, people may know one or two clients, but or partners, but in the end, for us, it's all about the team. We've been very lucky in the last year. The firm has received numerous awards through its history, but at the moment, holding really the, you know, the trifecta, I suppose, of the most prestigious awards in the market. Earlier this year, Dealmakers, the Legal Dealmakers awards were announced for the Dealmakers of the Decade, and Webber Wentzel was awarded the Legal Dealmakers of the Decade in terms of value of transactions that we've done over the last decade. We're also currently the Law Firm of the Year, as awarded by the South African Professional Services Industry. We're also the African Law Firm of the Year, which we won at the African Legal Awards late last year, and so on. So it's a really privileged position to be in. We're very grateful for our clients that we are able to be in that position, and for all of the lawyers and business support services staff within the firm that really supports our firm. We've got an incredibly professional outfit, both on the lawyer side, but also in terms of business, our business services staff. That really has enabled us over the last a decade or so to really be involved in some of the highest profile matters in the market. I almost can't think of one of the large transactions that this firm has not done. That includes issues and transactions such as the AB InBev takeover of SAB Miller, the restructuring of the Naspers Group last year, where we spun out the MultiChoice listing separately on the JSE, and then the overseas assets listed in the Netherlands under the name Process. We restructured the Coca-Cola bottling operations in Africa for the clients. We did the Old Mutual coming home transaction over the last couple of years, in terms of which Old Mutual's listing in London was moved back to the JSE, and retained listings in Malawi, Namibia, Zimbabwe, and in South Africa. We did the Walmart takeover of Massmart. We did the Woolworths transaction as they entered into Australia. We did some of the Mercer, both the acquiry of Alexander Forbes at the time, and earlier, late last year, and early this year, the sell down of Mercer's interest in Forbes, etc. Those are all really significant corporate transactions that the firm have been involved in. Those are the type of transactions that really land on the front pages of the Business Day and other newspapers and make people really understand. But none of those transactions are possible, obviously, not only because of the people we have in the firm, but also the relationships we have with other firms. We service our clients across Africa through a network of best friend firms, some of which are pursuant to exclusive alliance type bilateral agreements. We have those agreements in Namibia, in Nigeria, and in Ethiopia. Then we have best friend relationships into other countries such as Mauritius, such as Kenya, Zambia, Malawi, Zimbabwe, and in Botswana as well. And that's really important for us to be able to put the best people in a particular market with us on a transaction for our clients. You know, the Walmart transaction, for example, you know, I led that transaction. We worked, 18 African jurisdictions were involved. We used 153 lawyers within Webber Wentzel on that matter, and then also the lawyers on the continent. So that's really important from a big law firm perspective. Other transactions like SAB Miller transaction, that was a transaction where we managed the entire Africa piece, but we work very closely with firms across the globe, and in particular with Linkladders as well. That's our alliance partner. We have a very strong network with Linkladders. We share know-how, both in terms of behind the scenes information, which is really encouraging, and then we also refer matters to each other in relation to jurisdictions where we feel that clients will be best served. But the other thing I think that's really important from a firm perspective is not only the client work and the transactional work we do, but the firm is really committed to its place in the market and making sure that we give back as well. We've got a very, very big and very dedicated pro bono department. We were the first law firm in South Africa to have dedicated pro bono lawyers, a whole department of pro bono lawyers. Through its history, we've done incredible work in terms of the initial focus was on housing and women and children's rights. as well as in that time, the HIV pandemic. That has morphed a little bit in still doing all of that work, but doing a lot more work in the rule of law space and making sure that we protect the Constitution. This firm has been involved in virtually all of those rule of law and constitutional law cases that were in front of the Constitutional Court during the previous couple of years, including relating to the enforcement of the public protector's reports, making sure that Parliament complies and that the President in those days comply with the rulings, that the right people get appointed to the National Prosecuting Authority, etc. All of those behind the scenes cases on the rule of law our firm were involved in for a number of clients. We also acted for the family of the late Ahmed Timol, who was an anti-apartheid activist who died in police custody in the early 1970s. And at the time, his death was ruled a death by suicide. And we, of course, and his family for decades have believed that, in fact, he was murdered. And that case eventually came to court last year, where we were able to prove, and that the court ultimately ruled that he was pushed to his death. And then a 46-year-old inquest ultimately were overturned. And I think we are really proud of that work. The next phase is now underway to make sure that people get prosecuted, even though it happened decades ago. Also very proud and in fact received awards internationally for the work we did in with the University of Stellenbosch's Law Clinic and some very low income workers in relation to challenging the emoluments attachment orders that were going on in South Africa, where people were shopping around for particular forums, and in the end some employees had so much debt that were taken off their salaries that they had nothing to live with. And we challenged the constitutionality of that, and ultimately the court changed that regime that you can't just do it, you need to now go through a court. And that was found, I think it was about 3 years ago, to be the best pro bono case in the world by the International Bar Association. And our lawyers that were involved, which from our Cape Town office, they ultimately were awarded the Attorney of the Year internationally by the International Bar Association. So a lot of that type of work we're really proud of. Currently, through this horrible COVID-19 pandemic, our firm sits on the Executive Council of the Business for South Africa, a group helping business and government to overcome some of the challenges. We've done a lot of pro bono work and coordinated and made sure that all the other law firms in South Africa contribute to that as well. We have we've managed to ensure that we also do our bit there to make sure the government and the business sector all work together. So that's just some of the things we've done. Nozipho, I don't know if there's anything that you would like to add, and also perhaps talk about what are the things we're looking for in an attorney. You're on the transformation management committee, and maybe you're well placed to talk to our students about what we are looking for in a candidate.
No, sure, Christo. I think that the one thing that struck me as you were speaking is the fact that what it is that we deal with on a day-to-day basis are cutting-edge matters, matters that are relevant to the country, matters that matter from an economic point of view, from a social point of view. And I think that the general perception out there is that lawyers are really concerned with things like the lex commissoria, the sui generis rule, and other things that are archaic in their construct. But really, that is absolutely not the case, because of the fact that the clients that we have on our books are clients that are concerned with what is that's happening out there, and what it is that we are experiencing on a day-to-day basis. And so what it is that then requires from us is for us to be able to be innovative in how it is that we approach the law, in how it is that we approach day-to-day situations. And it also requires us to be able to be flexible and to be able to adapt, to take account of how it is that our clients are doing things, so that we are able to properly service our clients to the best of our abilities. Because of the fact that if we are stuck in doing things in the way that things were done in 1960 or 1980, there's no way that a young tech company will be able to find any form of common ground with us. And so that's what it is that we're looking for. We're looking for the lawyer of tomorrow. And the lawyer of tomorrow is not a person that is able to recite, you know, the court rules. Yes, that's an important quality, of course. But what it is that we are looking for are people that are game changers, disruptors, which is a popular word in this time that we're living in. That's what it is that we're looking for. People that can actually take the firm to the future. And I think that that's something that the firm has done quite well so far, to get people that are able to see what's happening out there, to be able to move with the times, and to also require management to see the importance of certain things that are happening out there. And then one example I like to give is the fact that when I started at Webber's, DDs used to take place in one room with probably 8 desks and with a whole horde of files. And that's how it is that we used to assess risk from a transaction perspective. Now, on the other hand, we are able to do that from anywhere in the world. And we're able to assess risk, look at documents, et cetera, and to be able to advise clients without actually even stepping foot at the client's premises. But that all happens because of the fact that we are innovative in how it is that we look at things, and we are not closed off insofar as adapting to the technology that is available to us. We are not closed off insofar as looking at how it is that we can be more efficient in how it is that we service clients. And that's something that's particularly important, taking into consideration where we are now. I mean, as I'm speaking to you, I'm in the Midlands, and notwithstanding the fact that I'm not anywhere near the office, I'm able to participate in this session, all because of the fact that, you know, we work in an environment that embraces the technology that is available to us. And that is what it is that is important for tomorrow's purposes, is being able to see what it is that's available out there, looking at what it is that we can do to be able to be more efficient in how it is that we conduct ourselves, and basically getting people in to the firm that are able to adapt, to be innovative, and to be game changers. So I think that that's what it is that we look for. Christo, maybe we've spoken enough, I think. I see that we have a whole horde of questions. Perhaps this is a good time for us to look at some of the questions. I see that we have a number of questions here. Emma Dodgen has asked, what is one of the attributes that you like to see in CAs you work closely with? Christo, do you want to take that first?
Yeah, thanks. There's a couple of good questions, and perhaps just to tell everybody, we, clearly the teacher was right when they said I speak too much. We've gone way over our time, but we are extending the session so that those of you that can remain online, if that is possible. If our team can tell me we need to cut off, we'll cut off, but otherwise very happy to continue to answer your questions. So what do I look for? There's so many good attributes, as Nozipho said. I think for me, one of the things that are really, important from a candidate attorney is enthusiasm. You know, we often see, everybody that ultimately joins the firm, would be somebody that is really intelligent, that is thoughtful, that is able to produce excellent work. So in a way, that is almost a given. We work really hard, and I like working with people that are actually want to be here and are enthusiastic to be here. As I said earlier, this is a bit like a family for me, and I don't like working for people, even if they're the brightest minds out there, that takes a piece of work and are sullen, sit in their office, don't greet you when you walk in the corridors, etc. I'm looking for somebody that wants to be here, that is very keen to do a piece of work. I still have partners today that when I have a great big transaction and I pass it on, that are like, oh, thank you so much for involving me. I really, really like working with you, and so on. And that's an attitude that I think is something that is really encouraging. You want to work with somebody like that. So for me, it's that. There's tons of other things that are important, but for me, making the environment the place where you are enthusiastic about doing the work with me, I really like that. Nozipho said, I'll try and go through. Did I miss a question or should I just go through some of the questions? There's actually one for you that Emma also asked about your favorite case, Nozipho, in your career in media law. Let's take that and then I'll go. There's quite a few questions about the pandemic, which I'm happy to answer.
Oh, absolutely. I can definitely answer the question of my favorite case. And in fact, it was the very first case that I attended. I was a first year CA, and this is important because of the fact that I really, really, really was obsessed with Winnie Mandela when it is that I was growing up. So we got involved in a non-profit organization case when it is that I joined the media team. And so as a reward, if I can call it that, I then got invited to a dinner party, and I was going to be sitting at the same table with the late Ms. Winnie Mandela. And so I'd been looking forward to this probably for months. I even bought a new suit, I remember. So on the day of the dinner, Pamela Stein, a partner at the firm, comes to my office and says, we have an urgent interdict that has been brought by a politician. I won't name the politician. The Mail and Guardian wants to fight it. Do you want to be involved? And I said, absolutely. So she says, it will probably take a couple of hours. I know that you're looking forward to that dinner. So we will probably be in and out of court. I don't think that this is going to succeed in any way, shape or form. So let's go. So we prepared papers. We went to court. And lo and behold, we were still in court by 10 p.m. So, of course, I was given the option to leave, but I was like, there's absolutely no way I'm walking out of this situation. So the Mail and Guardian lost that case. And so we then had to go back to the Mail and Guardian's offices to basically craft a newspaper that was going to go out that day. I got home, I think it was 4 a.m. And I still have that paper. It's still in my office. And what it is that they did, which I thought was so incredibly clever, was to basically put a blank page, a black page with the words censored on the cover. And so that's what it is that they decided to do because of the fact that the story that was going to go out that day was censored. So for me, that will always stand out as being my absolute, absolute favorite case.
Thanks, Nancy, but sounds like it was more interesting than your dinner. In fact, all our students may not even have been born, but when I was at university, you know, we sadly in those dark days during the 80s and so on had censorship all around. And you know, initially, obviously, the newspapers complied. And I think it was the Free Weekblad was the first one that actually crossed out the words they may not use or just blacked out, but used the whole article and then paragraphs were blacked out. And it was kind of, you know, it was such a clever way of making people realize, you know, what is going on that, you know, you are not allowed to read about. So anyway, so we're repeating that, which is interesting. There's a lot of questions from our students, of course, about the pandemic, how it is affecting our intake. You know, what are we going to do about it and all of that. I think a couple of things are relevant here. The firm has been incredibly successful in operating seamlessly outside of the office during the course of the pandemic. I'm in the office today, but you know, I come in very seldom. I mainly work from home, as does most other people. So, you know, so that's been the great benefit of technology. You know, I think lawyers generally are quite lucky in that regard, that we are able to continue to practice. The difficulty, of course, come in, you know, what happens with your clients and, you know, are there going to be less transactions and so on? And the real benefit, again, and I always say law firms are really good business operations because they are very balanced between, you know, areas that are very successful when the economy is doing really well and areas that are very successful when the economy is not doing well. So, you know, through COVID, yes, those big M&A transactions I spoke about, I think we're going to see few of those maybe in the coming year. And you know, at the moment, there's one or two actually bubbling under, but there's not a lot going on in that space. But the firm's been incredibly busy in other spaces, in our employment space, in the interpretation of regulations. You know, we've done the the BATSA challenge of the regulations on cigarettes, for example. In the insurance sector, sadly, in the business rescue and insolvency sector, restructurings and debt transactions and so on, that's been busy. So the firm actually is not that impacted. We've taken tons of measures to make sure that the firm remains as stable as possible. And there is a lot of risks in the market, but we've been able to navigate that quite successfully, and the firm is actually in a very good position. As far as CAs are concerned, I think that the one benefit, of course, is that we recruit a couple of years ahead. So the people that will start in 2021 have been recruited previously as well. So that's a benefit. We have no plans of changing that. But the importance is, for a firm that's been around for this long, is that we plan for the long term. You cannot only plan for this year and next year. You always have to have a future trajectory. So, it is something that will be in our minds as to the number of people and the shape that we recruit. But the overarching importance for us is that not what we need today, but what we need in 5, 10, 15 years time, because that's where we see the trajectory of the firm. It's not just at the moment. You know, when the same happened in 2007, 2008 with the global financial crisis or the IT disasters in 2000 and, through the 80s and so on. I think the nice thing about the longevity of the firm is that the ability, as Nozipho also mentioned, is, you kind of have to roll with the punches, and as long as you keep your eyes on the horizon and look to the future, then, you should be okay. So it will be in our minds, but it will not be the overarching factor. And we certainly, I'm not aware of plans to recruit fewer people in the coming years. We've answered some questions on, Nozipho. Yeah.
There's a question here around how much direction/autonomy is there in candidate attorney position? I think that the one thing that I want to mention there is that obviously you will always have autonomy, but the one thing that I want to emphasize there insofar as how it is that you must approach articles is that articles are really there to enable you as a candidate to learn. And so the autonomy does come insofar as how it is that you approach your learnership and your time at the firm when it is that you are doing articles. But really what it is that I would encourage and what it is that I would say is that really try to embrace the learning experience. So you have at your disposal when it is that you come to the firm some of the greatest legal minds that we have in the country. And so how it is that you must really approach that is to basically try to extract as much as you can from the people that are there, whether it be the associate, senior associates or partners. Really, the autonomy comes in when it is that you really are able to extract the knowledge that you want or that you need to gain in that period. So rather than look at it from an autonomy point of view, rather look at it in the converse to say, how much can I learn from these individuals that I am exposed to on a day-to-day basis? That is really what's important.
Great, thanks. So, sorry, I think we need to get through some of these questions. So if you don't mind, yes. I'm going to ask also answer these questions quickly. So if I'm not as full as I normally am, forgive me. There's a question about Luminance. So for those of you that don't know, so Luminance is a tool that is used in relation to contract management and in particular in relation to due diligence or discovery where there's large volumes of documents and you need to get specific summaries or clauses, etc. Webber Wentzel, again, one of the few firms and I think one of the first firms in the country to have a dedicated department that deals with high volume documentation and contract management type of contracts. We incorporate that, not in every matter. It's very matter specific, but in particular on diligences. And I think our litigation department does a lot in relation to discovery when there's particular clauses that we are looking for. And the interesting thing is, Luminance is only as, and not only Luminance, I think all these types of tools are only as strong as the lawyers that operate them and the input that they provide in relation to training them. They don't train themselves. They look for things that you have kind of searched in the past and so on. So I think it's still very early days. I'm not of the school that think that computers are going to take over and do everything that lawyers do. I think they are going to become a tool which lawyers will use to progress matters and documents at high speed and so on. So that's kind of where we use Luminance at the moment in those two areas, I think, principally. There was a question about the various practice areas. So the firm has five large departments. They are corporate, which really does, as it says, corporate and M&A type of matters. We have banking, finance, regulatory, so financial regulatory work, banking work, projects work, that's there. We have a tax department, we have a dispute resolution department, and then we have a commercial department, which consists of a number of areas that are important in relation to commercial relationships. So the media department, for example, TMT, technology and media, with Nozipho, we are there. We've got property. We have public law, we have competition law, we have employment law. Am I missing anything, Nozipho, in that department? So it is commercial. We do the full suite of what you would require as a corporation. We do not do really family law, and we don't do criminal law. But the rest we basically all do. How do you know where you should be or want to be? The real answer is you really don't, because what you think a particular area is may not be what you think, what you ultimately experience. When I was at university, constitutional law was really new, and I just wanted to be a constitutional lawyer. Now I'm on the other side doing big corporate work and so on. But when you start, you really don't know, which is the benefit, as Nozipho also said, of rotating through the firm. So the way we do it is when you start, you get allocated to different areas, and every 8 months you rotate through the firm, so you have a taste of what a corporate department looks like. You have a taste of one of the commercial units, and you can get a taste of our litigation DR department. And then at the end, you will get an offer depending on where your interests are. We try and allocate people as to the first choices in our rotations, etc. And then in the end, that kind of works out. But what also happens is somebody starts in a particular area and years later they switch to another area. It doesn't happen often, but we are flexible if that does happen, and we have had that in the past.
Christo, there's a question here that I see around what are the goals that WW takes in moving towards transformation, and most especially looking at LGBTI right advancement and gender equality. I think that the one thing to mention there is that we have a transformation committee that looks at these issues, not only from a race point of view, but from transformation and diversity in the broad sense. I mean, one of the things that we are looking at, both from a TMC perspective and from a transformation perspective, is the issue of gender neutrality. And that, I know, we know that that's something that's particularly important, and we're looking at those types of issues on a daily, how it is that we can make sure that each and every single individual within the firm feels as if they are home, that they are able to be themselves, and that they don't necessarily have to feel as if they are in any way, shape or form ostracized or oppressed in any way. I also see a question here around, what do you do if you are assigned a case you are morally opposed to? How do you reconcile conflict between your personal beliefs and the case? That's a very interesting and hard question. And in fact, this is a question that I usually ask whenever it is that I'm interviewing candidates. And the fact of the matter is that I think that as a firm, we don't expect you to ever compromise yourself. So where it is that you are feeling particularly compromised from a personal point of view, it's incumbent on you to speak up. And what it is that the firm gets right is that you will never ever be shut down, and you will never be forced to do something that you are fundamentally opposed to doing. And so, and you won't also be judged if you take that view. But and one of the things that tends to happen is that we have oftentimes have robust discussions around issues of conflict. We look at matters and we approach matters taking into consideration the values that we subscribe to as a firm. So that is something that we hold in particular high regard, and that's something that is a constant issue of discussion. So where it is that issues of conflict come about, there's never a situation where it is that somebody will not be listened to when it is that they express some form of discomfort when it comes to a matter.
Thanks, Nozipho. You know, we've got real examples of that on some of those matters I mentioned before. You know, so we on the SAB Miller AB InBev merger, for example, there was some of our Muslim colleagues that said they don't want to work on an alcohol-related matter, for example, and that was fine. You know, we rotated them out of the matter and worked on other matters. It is a very important question, because not only in relation to, you know, historically law firms have been, you know, kind of above all of this, do each and everything, but I think also the era of state capture has made us as much more astute in terms of turning matters away about what type of matters. That it's a slightly different question, but it's related. Now, we've got an in-house counsel. We have a committee that looks at matters that are perhaps sensitive in that space, etc. And you know, we would much rather turn work away. You know, in that height of state capture matters. Now, at one point, we were offered on a particular client, which we already flagged as somebody we shouldn't be acting for, you know, 5 times normal rate to do a particular piece of work. And the firm said, we're not interested. We're not going to do work for that client. So I think that's also important to know. We spoke about the pandemic. There's a question about where do associates come from? I think it's a combination. We have, of course, people that have grown up in the firm, people that have been CAs like Nozipho and I that have kind of gone through the firm. But we also a firm that really enjoys bringing in lateral hire. So, you know, our motto is we want the best people in the market to work at Webber Wentzel. And if by some misfortune you ended up at a different firm and you see the light and now want to come to us, awesome that we are open to that. We always recruit laterally as well. How would you describe the culture of Webber? We spoke a little bit about that. You know, excellence is key. Everything we put out must be excellent. I think that's important. We have a very collaborative culture. I think, as I said before, at Webber Wentzel, it's not about the individuals. It's about the teams and how we can collaboratively work. We are only able to service those large matters because we can bring in expertise from a number of teams. So collaboration is really important. I think we are commercially astute. You know, it doesn't help clients that you give a legally correct answer. They want to know, am I able to do this transaction in a legal way? So you have to think about the matter commercially. What makes commercial sense? No client in practice wants to read a 100-page opinion with footnotes and references to law cases, etc. Nobody's interested in that. Clients must know that you know that, but they want to know the answer that's relevant to their business. So we very, very you know, very clear on our opinion work, for example, that it must be commercially useful. So I think that all of that goes into some of what we see at the culture of the firm.
I see we also have a Linklaters question and how it is that has helped us in Africa. Do you want to take that as well?
Yeah, thanks, Nozipho. I think Africa was one of the important factors of entering into the alliance with Linklaters. We have historically always worked very well with Linklaters. You know, we have joint clients going back 50, 60 years in terms of working for Anglo-American, for example, jointly and so on. But when we looked at the continent, we very much looked at what happened in the Australian market and how the Australian firms were overrun by international firms and how that influenced their work in the region. A lot of the work on the continent is English law based. So whether you're sitting in Zambia or Nigeria or Kenya or elsewhere, South Africa is probably the exception where, you know, our law is very much determined on local law. Whereas in the rest of Africa, it's either, you know, for big transactional work, it's either English law, Portuguese, which is Lusophone law, or Francophone for the French-speaking countries. And we had a choice at the time whether to build up an internal capacity to be able to do that work or to enter into the alliance. But we thought that, you know, to be an alliance with, you know, what I consider to be one of the greatest law firms in the world, and to work together on those types of matters is much better. And that's the route we've gone. We still have people in Webber Wentzel that can also practice English law, etc. But it really helps us to do work which is of a scale and of a reputation of that nature. We did a very important transaction which ultimately in the end didn't proceed, but a pipeline between Ethiopia and Djibouti, for example, that Webber Wentzel would never be able to attract. It's just a company sitting in New York would need to know that you were able to do that work. And a lot of the operational type of project work Linklaters didn't do. So they do the big finance, international finance work, but putting a team together that can deal with both aspects and have the international reputation and name of Linklaters has really helped us secure that mandate. So I think that's some of the benefits of the alliance in working on the continent together.
Christo, I think the last question that I see here that we really haven't covered is the issue of where it is that we think Webber Wentzel will be in 5 years. And that really is a question that falls squarely within your ambit.
Thanks, Nozipho. Yeah, we're very structured in terms of our strategic planning. We have five-year plans. We had a very structured five-year plan when we were elected, Sally and I, to our positions now 5.5 years ago, and which the firm very successfully completed. And we were in the process of looking at a five-year plan when COVID started. We've reserved that for the moment and just adopted a one-year plan just to kind of manage ourselves through the pandemic. But for us, it is key that we remain the trusted advisor to our clients, to have when clients need assistance from lawyers, that they think of us first. One of the things we are doing and that we will roll out in the next 5 years is not only concentrate on the immediate and the strategy, but also look at what is the firm's purpose. We are in a position where people within society and broader look up to the role we play. So the purpose of our organization is becoming really important. And you can do some research on some of the large research institutions in the world, whether out of Harvard or McKinsey or otherwise, organizations that have a purpose as opposed to just, and the purpose isn't to make money, the money bit is a consequence of running a good organization. You must have a purpose as to why you exist. And a lot of thinking is going into what is our purpose and where do we want to be in relation to not only our strategy, but our purpose in 5 years' time. So that I think is high on our agendas.
All right. The last question that I think I want to take is from Sipu Musa. He asks how it is that we've supported people that have been working from home in this time that may not necessarily be equipped to be able to work from home. And so what it is that we did first and foremost, and I think that it was absolutely the best thing that we could have done at the time, is prior to us going on lockdown, we launched Microsoft Teams, which has enabled us to be able to keep in touch with our colleagues, both from a meeting point of view, but to also keep in touch from a social point of view. I mean, we've had team lunches, if I can call it that, through Microsoft Teams. And what it is that we've done basically is we've given our colleagues the abilities to be able to connect to the internet, as well as laptops and other equipment that is necessary for you to be able to work on a day-to-day basis. So what it is that we've basically managed to do is to recreate our office space in our homes, and that's made all the difference, because nothing is different really, other than the fact that we don't see each other on a day-to-day basis. We're able to work, we're able to connect, we're able to see each other, albeit not physically, but we're still able to see each other. And we're also able to socialize, which is also quite important, because one of the things that I've discovered is how important it is to actually be able to speak to the people that I work with and to be able to find out how it is that they're doing on a day-to-day basis. And so because of the technology and the infrastructure that we've made available to our colleagues and to the people that we work with, that is actually something that we've been able to do quite seamlessly. So we're able to continue as if life is normal despite the pandemic.
Yeah, thanks Ziba. It's certainly normal in a different way. Let's answer the two last questions quickly. There was a question from Nao in relation to how relevant it is for somebody to align themselves with a principal in a desired area of expertise, talking about aviation and maritime. I think a lot of that depends on the practice area. You know, the practice areas you've mentioned, aviation and maritime, you know, we have teams in relation to both of those. I think that real specialized areas, it is much better to be able to work with somebody that have that skills because it is quite specialized. But people have that ability, as I said before, you know, people move into aviation or maritime, perhaps sometimes later in their career, they've been a litigator and now, you know, they're in the Cape Town office and they want to do more in maritime. You know, so it can develop, but to the extent that it is a possibility that you can work with somebody already having that skills, I think that is a plus. But don't narrow yourself too early in your career because, you know, as I said, it's important to also see what you don't know and look at other areas as well, because maybe you find something that you enjoy even more. So I think that's the one question. And then Andrew wrote, you know, he's a financial accountant with a long career already. And is that possible to transition into the legal profession? The answer is yes, absolutely. And we've had examples of that. We have one of our best junior partners, I suppose, that's where she is in her career now in a Webber's context. But before she joined us, she was and had practiced for many, many years as a dentist and then, you know, requalified as an attorney and ultimately came here for articles. It does take a complete mind shift, which is why I admire her so much for, you know, having had a full career in a completely different area. You know, to start articles at a firm where, you know, your colleagues are, you know, all in their early 20s and you may be 40, you know, I think takes quite a special person. But with the determination, absolutely, she has thrived since she's been at the firm and really happy with her career choice. So it is possible. It does take a little bit of adjustment, I think, just personally, but from a firm perspective, you know, as Nozipho also mentioned earlier, you know, we want interesting people. And ultimately, that is what you know, you will contribute to the firm. So I think all of that experience is never wasted. It really is something that will ultimately stand you in very good stead if you do wish to join a law firm. I assume you have an LLB, then you must apply for articles as anybody else. If you haven't done articles yet, just look at our website and contact our HR department. I hope that we skipped some questions, but I think some of those questions were already answered in some of the observations we made earlier. But by all means, as I said before, on Nozipho and my behalf and on Webber's behalf, thank you for joining us today. We certainly had a long session. Hope you found it interesting. I hope we see you at Webber Wentzel in due course. By all means, go on our website, look at our social media page, follow us there, and you're very welcome to also post questions there or send us questions by email. Our addresses are online as well. But for us today, I think that does bring us to an end. So thank you very much for joining us. It's been a real privilege to speak to you this afternoon.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Thanks, Nozipho.
Thanks, Christopher.